Well, thank you, Kylie. We're going to be informal today, so I'll make very brief introductions. Doug Wilson is pastor of Christ Church in Moscow, Idaho, the author of numerous books. He is the founder and Johnny Appleseed of the classical Christian school movement. I know a bunch of you did go to classical Christian schools, and so you probably can thank Doug or complain to him. Christopher Hitchens studied politics, philosophy, and economics at Oxford. Three-fourths of our students, Chris, major in PP&E, so I'm sure you will feel their pain. After college, he joined the Trotskyist wing of the International Socialist Movement, but in 2003, he incurred the anger of the left by supporting the war in Iraq. Doug, let's start off with the affirmative. In 2 minutes, tell us why Christianity is good for the world.
There are two levels where that question can be addressed. One would be the level that I would, as a Christian minister, address it. It's good for the world because it's the truth of the gospel for the world. Now, there are many who would answer it on another level, sort of a more pragmatic approach, where they would say religion generally is good for the world as a form of social control, and it gives people comfort and consolation, and it keeps them from doing terrible bad things to one another. The problem with that, as Christopher will hasten to inform you, is that it often is the occasion for wars and conflicts between differing religions. So I want to defend not religion as a generic good for the world as a social control, but rather that the Christian faith, because Jesus is the Christ of God, is good for the world. The Christian gospel is nothing if not the message that Jesus Christ is the last Adam. The word Adam means mankind in Hebrew. So when we're told, when the Apostle Paul tells us that Jesus is the last Adam, he's saying Jesus is the ultimate mankind, the final mankind. We have the option of growing up into our maturity as human beings in Christ, and there's no other option. There's no other way. Now, if that claim is true, objectively true, then it has to be good for the world by definition. It's the salvation of the world. Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. How would that not be good? Of course, if the claim is false, if Jesus was delusional or a charlatan, then, of course, Christianity is no more good for the world than any other widely circulated lie.
Okay, Chris, why is Christianity bad for the world?
First, because it's based on a fantastic illusion. Let's say that the consensus is that our species, we being the higher primates, Homo sapiens, has been on the planet for at least 100,000 years, maybe more. Francis Collins says maybe 100,000. Richard Dawkins thinks maybe a quarter of a million. I'll take 100,000. In order to be a Christian, you have to believe that for 98,000 years, our species suffered and died, most of its children dying in childbirth, most other people having a life expectancy of about 25, dying of their teeth, famine, struggle, bitterness, war, suffering, misery, all of that for 98,000 years. Heaven watches it with complete indifference. And then 2,000 years ago thinks, that's enough of that. It's time to intervene. The best way to do this would be by condemning someone to a human sacrifice somewhere in the less literate parts of the Middle East. Let's appear to the Chinese, for example, where people can read and study evidence and have a civilization. Let's go to the desert and have another revelation there. This is nonsense. It can't be believed by a thinking person. Why am I glad this is the case, to get to the point of the wrongness in the other sense of Christianity? Because I think the teachings of Christianity are immoral. The central one is the most immoral of all. That is the one of vicarious redemption. You can throw your sins onto somebody else. Vulgarly known as scapegoating, in fact, originating as scapegoating in the same area, the same desert. I can pay your debt if I love you. I can serve your term in prison if I love you very much. I can volunteer to do that. I can't take your sins away because I can't abolish your responsibility, and I shouldn't offer to do so. Your responsibility has to stay with you. There's no vicarious redemption. There very probably, in fact, is no redemption at all. It's just a part of wish thinking, and I don't think wish thinking is good for people either. It even manages to pollute the central question, the word I just employed, the most important word of all, the word love, by making love compulsory, by saying you must love. You must love your neighbor as yourself, something you can't actually do, but you'll always fall short, so you can always be found guilty. by saying you must love someone who you also must fear. That's to say, a supreme being, an eternal father, someone of whom you must be afraid, but you must love him too. If you fail in this duty, you're again a wretched sinner. This is not mentally or morally or intellectually healthy, and that brings me to the final objection. I'll condense it, Dr. Alasky, which is that this is a totalitarian system. If there was a God who could do these things and demand these things of us, and who was eternal and unchanging, we would be living under a dictatorship from which there was no appeal, and one that could never change, and one that knows our thoughts and can convict us of thought crime and condemn us to eternal punishment for actions that we are condemned in advance to be taking. All this in the round, and I could say more, it's an excellent thing that there's absolutely no reason to believe any of it to be true.
Okay, Doug, are you a thinking person, or are you left speechless by Chris's assault?
I give up.
Christopher. Would you mind calling me Christopher? I'm sorry, it's only because it's my name.
All right.
Thank you.
Here's, I think, is the central difficulty of Christopher's critique of the Christian faith. You notice that he's not critiquing the Christian faith by appealing to a standard that overarches all human beings and that is obligatory for all of us. When he says things like substitutionary atonement is immoral, well, by what standard? Who says? What do you mean immoral? What worldview considers it to be immoral, and why is that worldview in charge of the Christian worldview? All ultimate truth claims are, to use postmodern jargon, totalizing. You can't talk about everything without talking about everything. And what Christopher has to do in order to critique the Christian faith is he has to borrow ethical standards from the Christian faith and run a reductio, where he says, you, according to the standards that you adopt as Christians, here, let me climb into that. Let me climb into the Christian car and see if I can drive it into a tree. That's what he's doing. But he doesn't have any car to drive of his own, right? Why? Substitutionary atonement is immoral. How come? Who says?
Very well.
Chris, yes. Are you a car thief?
Now here we are. I haven't known Douglas Wilson for very long, but he does strike me as a very sweet and decent and generous and humane person, and thus he obviously doesn't know how insulting, how rude he's just been. Not just to me, but not just to me, not just to your humble servant, the carjacker, but to you, you also, ladies and gentlemen. I think it's a fantastically rude thing to say that if it wasn't for Christianity, I and you wouldn't know right from wrong. It's an extraordinary thing to say. The awareness of the difference between right and wrong is innate in human beings, and it can be found and noticed, being observed and enforced and upheld. In societies where Christianity has never yet penetrated. To say that no one... let me give an example from the Old Testament. The story, as you know, of the wandering in the Sinai and the wandering in the desert and so is all made up. It's a Jewish foundational myth. But the Ten Commandments, four or five of which do actually contain moral injunctions. Some of them are nonsensical, some of them are theocratic, some of them are self-contradictory, but the ones that say, on the whole, avoid murder, theft, and perjury are, I would consider, sound, and I dare say everyone in this room would without necessarily having to be told. Are we to assume that my mother's ancestors, the ancient Jewish people, got all the way to Mount Sinai under the impression that murder, theft, and perjury were all okay, and only when told from on high, stop with that, suddenly thought maybe they are such bad ideas after all? Of course not. There couldn't have been a Jewish society or enough Jewish solidarity to get them that far, if they all thought these things are fine until God says that they are. This is not how morality is formed at all. To the contrary, as far as I can tell, religion gets its morality from humans. It's a feedback loop. And then it says, tells them to think of things that aren't sins as if they were. For example, coveting your neighbor's goods, a perfectly healthy thing to do. The ambition of jealousy and emulation that's the necessary spur to innovation and to progress then described quite ludicrously as a sin, and you're made